Jung again. When you're Jung at heart, maybe old Carl. You guys remember Carl Jung? There was this incredible impetus that occurred. I think it was the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th, people began to realize that there might be some science to the functionality of cognition. So some very famous names appeared on the landscape. For us less educated, the more prominent still stuck through, such as, of course, the very famous Sigmund Freud, and then Carl Jung. Now, Carl Jung's, Freud was like the, well, a lot of things. Indirectly, Freud started the advertising industry. And as I say, I was a Freud of that. Never know when that door is going to open. You have to have something for openers. No problem. I don't have a problem. You have to have something for openers. Look at this. It's like the can opener that has a very weak point, and that's the look into the can. It can open her, but not for long, because it has a bushing here made of the petroleum plastic, and it eventually fatigues and gives way, and you have to buy a whole new unit. Nevertheless, it's ingenious. Notice the twist so that you can have the famous church key scenario here. Open the can. Now, once you have this, instead of throwing it away, you can recycle it by using it again. That's the easiest recycle. Cheater recycle. So now what I can do is minimize the footprint of my can opener. I can also get creative here. Not. And anything that lies down can now be can do. It's the motto of the Seabees. Illustrious introduction, I'm sure now you're up to speed on this thing. Now, I have this, the thing about Freud was, I think it was his son-in-law, one of his sons-in-law, maybe the only son-in-law, from the United States of America, saw in Freud's progress in how the human mind might function a way to make money, much to Freud's horror, and he began to apply this to the advertising industry. So what happens is an insight into the functionality of reason and thinking and cognition leads to the control of the populace. Get everybody to spend with a profit margin of 5 cents, 25 cents, and you're talking billions of dollars here in a several-month period. And that's just for openers. Here we are with our opener again. as it's Shakespeare said I'm having trouble with my memory here. That's one of the problems. That's one of the things that happens with this. The more, the play about the more, as in the more the merrier, you know. Doth ope her ruby lips. Anyway, so. let's see here, real quick. It's going to be a quick one, hopefully. So, you see, maybe that is the reason for the advent of this, you know, the penchant for the scientific community to search for the golden BB, you know, the golden bullet, cure for cancer, Viagra Falls, you know, the yew tree now becomes the cure, and so on and so forth. And here's the magic bullet, something to force the public to buy. And let's buy the. While we do this, let's. The human being is now relegated to the lower dram levels of impulse buyers and consumers. These are no longer the vaunted. Clientele of yesteryear. Now you're just consumers trying to, as if you were a mound of termites. Hey, termites are cool. Maybe they have intelligence anyway. So enter Carl Jung, which is like almost useless because sleep, who needs it? You know, I got this joke. We'll use Jack and Fred here. Hey, yeah, hi, Jack. What's happening? Well, hey, don't say that. Don't say hi, Jack. Why? Well, they might put me on the no-fly list, you know. What do you mean the no-fly list? That's only people who don't have flies. That's very funny. Where'd you make up that joke on Fly Day? Okay. That no fly list, I don't know. Woo, that went over my head. Okay, so. Hey, Paul. What, Jack? Why the heck did you call us out here? You had a joke. What was it? I don't know. I'm beginning to forget. Oh, my God. He's forgotten a joke again. Okay, I remembered it. Let's go. All right, give me the script. This is nondescript, so you can see right through it.
I can see right through that one.
Well, every little bit helps. Okay. You know what, Paul? Sometimes you can be a real pain in the neck. I got props here. Somebody said, are you working? And, you know, the story of Scrooge and Jacob Marley, whenever Marley, the ghost, he wanted to come and bug Scrooge, get him out of his little rut, you know, he says, I have been around the world in my travels and my chain grows longer. Well, this is the case, like every time I travel, my keychain gets bigger and bigger, so I've always had a key. This is a small one. It used to be going down to here. Twice around the world, you know. Every time I went around, my keychain got bigger, and I forgot where everything went. Anyway, so, you know, I'm working at the Mart, and the manager comes up, some assistant of an assistant of an assistant, and, you know, like overcompensating junior executive. And, you know, the Mart can only afford cheap management, so you get low quality management, and they're overtaxed, overburdened, so they're burnt out. are you working? And I pull out my keychain and say, no, I'm working. See, I'm working. Hoping no bruises, I might break a monitor. And this is my joke, see. As I'm working, I fly away. Oh, you tired fingers. How was that for a prop? No, I need to go to the prop yet. Paul, we're waiting. Okay, Jack and Bill, take it away. Okay, how far do we take this? Give me an aspirin. I'll take an aspirin. Okay. Jack. Yeah, Bill. I've been having a lot of trouble here with lack of sleep. Well, all you have to do is just lap yourself a little bit. Not masochism here, just lightly, like. And help you stay awake. Sounds like a good plan. Time, passage of time. 1 week later. I hope I remember their names. What, you forgot our names? Jack and Bill. Okay. Hey, I'm Bill. I'm the one who pays the bills. Never mind about Jack. See. Oh, I get it. Jack and Bill went up the hill. And they said, what the hill? Okay. This is getting better and better. Okay, so Jack, Bill, whatever. What? So, how's it going with the lack of sleep? You're slapping yourself lightly. A little tap helps you stay awake, right? No, I'm still having lack of sleep. But now, it's different. Instead of lack of sleep, now I'm suffering from lock of slap. All that to say this. Lack of sleep is a bigger problem than we can ever imagine. Now what happened is, because they couldn't make consumerism out of this, they sort of left Jung in the subconscious past. Some people dig him up. You know, the type of guy who can afford to go to school and major in the humanities, while the other guys are out there paid off their college degree in, you know, like 6 weeks, and they're driving their, riding their motor, their motorboats, they're driving their motorboats down the Florida, around the Florida Keys, you know. And the only thing they're taking is the hue manatees. They're hewing manatees with the prop blades. Okay, anyway. All right. So maybe old Carl was onto something, but assessed it to mere psychology. Mere psychology. You know, when it comes, these guys never are able to really cure people. They haven't, from what I can gather of their concept of psychology, they're trying to treat disease when it's actually injury. They're trying to treat toxicity, and what they really need to do is have some kind of psychological triage here. But now, Carl, with his ideas of dreams and everything, hey, you're getting beyond psychology. You're getting into the field of, are you? Remember, are you is just another two letters of the alphabet, like EZ, and then you have the dormitory, which takes the N for on the entrance and turns it sideways so they can get their Z's. The biology of dreams. And dream food. You may be talking about nutrition. I mean, you're going shopping and you're going to the grocery store to get your bunk bed. This may be why lack of sleep to the extreme can be a killer. Now, let's get away from my jokes and get to real jokes here. It's a clever one. It's not really even a joke. I forgot the name of the author, but it's a lady who, a businesswoman who is writing this article about how in her apartment, her bedroom, the bed in her bedroom was getting to be merely a decoration. You know, Jack Parr quoting, I forgot now. So much for that memory. The funniest joke is to tell the truth. Now, this may be lack sleep to the extreme may be a killer. They usually associate homelessness with mental illness. One of the things about being homeless in a contemporary urban situation is, you're not going to get good sleep, good night's sleep, and it may lead to, as Jung was saying, mental disorders. Well, that's a side effect. It actually may be psychological malnutrition, maybe beyond psychological. Excuse me, I'm getting what I call desert throat. You gotta have something for dessert. It could be that there is a part of the organism that is, okay, now we're gonna have to reach. So we're dealing for a reachable vernacular here. I'm using poetic license. Extra-substantive. It's a hyphenated word. A lot of the English writers hate it when the Yanks use their hyphenated words. It's kind of like taking the easy way out, almost. I guess that's why you never see a hyphenated word in a Shakespeare play. The quintessence of the English writing. But here we go, extra substantive or non-substance. It might be fed. Now this is why I say non-substantive. It might be fed. The organism might be fed by the meaning or significance, for want there of a more accurate term, of dreams and dreaming. I hope we all get this. We need to probably have more respect for sleep. There may be also other functions of dreams. For example, without being stimulated, the mind extricates itself somehow for, I don't know why. Maybe if it's not used, it begins to spoil and needs to be removed. An amputation in the brain. So what happens is, it may be that during the sleep period, you get your REM and other types of dreams that actually stimulate the mind enough to keep it fresh. It's like the mind fridge, right? The mind fridge. Okay, but beyond that, we're looking at dreams. This is the substance that dreams, these are the things that dreams are made of. Food, brain food, non-substantive, maybe not just brain food. We know that the mind, that the body is able to put the essential nutrient of glycogen in the muscle system during a sleep time. Okay. So it might be fed, the body might be fed by the meaning or significance, for want of a more accurate term, of dreams and dreaming. This was something psychology pioneer Carl Jung was catching on to back at the beginning of the 20th century. But the discipline, the discipline of psychology, the scientific discipline psychology, gravitated toward the opposite character, Freud, and his concept of sexuality, reproductive impetus, sexuality. Perhaps another aspect of causes of mental illness, but in the case of Jung, he saw that dreams played some sort of role in psychological hygiene or sanity, as in, yes indeed folks, it's time for Corny to turn it up big. Christmas is over. Didn't you know it was in August? Nope. You're just guessing. Well, if I'm just guessing, then there is actually, if nothing else, the just in there. Yes, Sanity Claus is coming to town. He knows when you've been sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows when you've got lock of slap. So get some sleep for goodness sake, or else you'll get the quake instead of the piece of cake. Okay. So, yeah, as in Sanity Claus is coming to town and knows when you've been sleeping. Okay. So, the Native Americans recognized the need for dreams and how they served as good medicine, as it were, for mental stability. So, it could be that dreams are food for an aspect of the person that might be all too easily dismissed as psychological wellness. When it probably goes much further than that. It may be the food our non-substantive aspect is nourished by. She's a food, she's a food. She takes his sleep and treats him crude. That's parody, but guess what, man? These are the things that dreams are made of, you know? And the things that you dare to dream really, really do come true. How do they come true? Eat dinner, you continue. You dream, you got to have a dream. If you don't have a dream, how you going to have a dream come true? That's a happy time. Talkie time. Gotta find it on the harmonic here. Dreams. People are reaching. Once you get into songs, I mean, especially creative songs, usually the show tunes can get into creativity. They can get away with it. Whereas pop tunes, they have to stick with the genre. They got winter stickeritis. Baillie Hi will call you where the sky
meets the sea. Here am I, your special island. Come to me, come to me. Your own special hopes, your own special dreams bloom on the hillside and shine in the streams. If you try, you'll find me where the sky meets the sea.
Remember, that's from South Pacific.
Here am I, your special island. Come to me, come to me.
See? And departing from the norm, getting out of, you know, like World War II and the time this thing was written, and starting to reach through the subconscious. Jung saying, aha, ach du lieber, there is something to it.
And Freud said, no, it's all, everything's driven by biology, you know. Well, here we have what happens is the human logic and reason, the sense of the reasonable, the sense of deduction, cheapening something, bringing it out, oversimplifying it, trying to dumb it down, you know, when you reach, you realize there's something more than the substance here, and it is properly nourished by dreams, because the non-substantive existence, meaning, and significance are the criterion. You ever wonder how to bend a note? Well, you know what bends that note in there? You change the shape of your mouth, and the clastic nature of the air has the function of anti. It's anti-gravity that bends the note. Hear that? I'm using anti-gravity. Okay, what we're doing here is we're dealing with the unknown. It is somewhat disquieting, one must admit, but here is the penchant of it all, and that is this. Unknown to us, sleep is a vital quotient of our daily need. There is more to it than